downstairs, so I'm glad to see that it's going to be put back to use as a library again. So, Ginny, come on in. Okay, I'm Colleen Sawyer, and last spring I did this presentation at Front Range Community College, where I'm a student of history, and I had done a lot of research on World War II, and I started getting interested in the newspapers during World War II, the Stars and Stripes newspaper, and then I realized that it had started in World War I. So World War II was not the first time that the Stars and Stripes appeared. And I thought, well, that's interesting. I think I'll look into that. So I was able to do a lot of research about the beginning of Stars and Stripes, which is still being published now, today, all these years later, 100 years later, we still have Stars and Stripes. And when we're finished, one of the veterans from here gave me this bound copy of all of the copies of the Stars and Stripes from World War I. Now, it's in very bad shape. It's 100 years old, and it's newsprint, so it's really pretty much fallen apart. But I brought some little magnifying glasses, so if you're interested in, you know, reading some of the articles or looking at the advertising, the cartoons, and please feel free to use it, because it's really, you know, it's falling apart anyway, so you might as well enjoy it. When it turns to dust, I have to get rid of it, but for now, please enjoy it after the presentation. Okay. Extra, extra, read all about it. U.S. joins war in Europe. Newspapers played a central role in American lives in the early 20th century. They were the media of the time, the daily fare of nearly every meal in every family, so cheap and common and often undervalued. Hometown newspapers reported the important issues of the day in a timely and convenient way. In 1914, the country followed the political events in Europe. And in 1917, the United States entered World War I. The War Department wanted to provide the American soldiers in France with news from the front, as well as communication from home. The enlisted men needed information, amusement, and entertainment to keep their morale high and carry out their patriotic duty. On the battlefront, they needed reading material that was small, readily available, popular, and affordable. A military newspaper was the answer to that quest. On February 8, 1918, Stars and Stripes became the official service newspaper of the American Expeditionary Forces, the AEF, the first contingent of Americans to fight on European soil in World War I. The first issue opened with an order from General Black Jack Pershing, Army Bulletin Number 10. He stated, "The Commander-in-Chief has authorized the publication of a weekly newspaper by and solely in the interests of the personnel of the AEF. This newspaper has been named the Stars and Stripes. It will give the AEF news about itself, keeping every unit as fully informed as possible about what the entire AEF is doing." Pershing commissioned the newspaper to speak the thoughts of the new American Army and the American people for whom the Army has been drawn. Military officials believed that the best soldier is an informed soldier, and a newspaper would provide information for the American forces widely scattered across Europe. Stars and Stripes provided war stories from the field, correspondence, editorials, sports, poetry, illustrations, photographs, cartoons, and advertisements. It became the most popular means of communication and entertainment for the American soldiers in France. The newspapers differed from other military publications in several ways. First, it was not printed through the government printing office. It was not issued from the United States. It sold advertising, and the soldiers themselves wrote and published it. Stars and Stripes catered to the frontline soldier, so it enjoyed freedom from many of the restrictions of other government publications. The AEF was kept informed about battles throughout Europe and national news from home, and enjoyed entertainment features of poetry, letters, and artwork submitted by enlisted men. At first, the sports pages provided coverage of athletic events from home, including the World Series and different sports events like that. But on July 26, 1918, the sports page was canceled. The editors believed that any able-bodied man in the States should be fighting the war, not playing professional sports. So they stated, quote, "Until an Allied victory brings back peace, there is but one big league today for this paper to cover." So they canceled all the sports coverage in the paper, because they felt like anybody that was able enough to play sports should be over there fighting. Stars and Stripes became a unique experience for the American Expeditionary Forces in France for news, entertainment, an outlet for creativity, and distraction from battle. World War I was not the first time soldiers had read the Stars and Stripes. Union soldiers produced the first issue during the Civil War in 1861. The soldiers captured a newspaper plant in Broomfield, Missouri, and produced a one-page paper four times throughout the Civil War. So it actually did start in the Civil War. They had four issues, and then it shut down for 70 years until World War I. So then it started up again, and it was published all through World War I. When the United States entered World War I in 1917, General Pershing ordered a newspaper for the American forces, and the Stars and Stripes appeared again. It ran from February 8, 1918 until June 13, 1919. The paper arrived each Friday for 16 months, published from different locations all across France. The staff writers moved constantly, printing the paper as close to the front as possible on portable printing presses. And sometimes they borrowed presses from Paris newspaper plants. Captain Richard Waldo, formerly of the New York Times, devised a system by which soldier distributors or field agents at each army post distributed the paper by railroad, trucks, automobiles, and even a motorcycle. I didn't even know they had motorcycles, but they were delivering newspapers. Some papers arrived at the YMCA hospitality centers, or huts, and they were distributed there. The venture proved immediately popular with the soldiers, and the Stars and Stripes quickly sold out its first issue of 1,000 copies for the price of 50 French centimes, which was about 20 cents. The newspaper eventually reached a circulation of 526,000 at the height of its popularity in 1918, and only a paper shortage prevented more printed copies. So they had to stop printing when they ran out of paper. The editors of the newspaper received this comment from a daughter of one of the soldiers, quote, "Having received copies of the Stars and Stripes from our dear daddy in France, how jolly well our brave boys must appreciate reading the paper." Stars and Stripes followed the typical layout of American newspapers of the time. So it did look like the typical newspaper that was in the States. It used wide columns, all capital letter headlines, illustrated advertisements, photographs, and many cartoon drawings. The paper kept the hometown feel of local American newspapers, complete with regular columns, comic strips, editorials, foreign and stateside news, and sports for a while. One cartoonist even mimicked a women's page, which was popular in the civilian newspapers, to show fashions for the doughboys or American soldiers. The paper advertised popular American products as well as French restaurants and hotels. The American Expeditionary Forces enjoyed a familiar taste of home when they read the Stars and Stripes. Advertisements enticed soldiers to spend their military earnings. American and French companies advertised products that appealed exclusively to male audiences. So you could buy a Burberry's coat. You could buy a camera and a candy bar. Companies sold cigarettes, candy bars, razors, cameras, chewing gum, military outfits and equipment, clothing, shoes, books, and band instruments. I love this one. As a regular thing, eat your grape nuts. French shops and restaurants welcomed local business from the enlisted men. The advertisements exhibited reserve and decorum according to today's standards of consumer media, although modern truth in advertising claims did not exist. And down here at the bottom, Fatima cigarettes. According to the ads, Adams chewing gum relieved thirst and also prevented fatigue, and physicians and surgeons smoked Fatima cigarettes. So they didn't have all the restrictions that we have now on our products. The products could be shipped from the United States or bought in stores in France. Organizations such as the YMCA, the Science Reading Rooms, the Harvard Club of Paris, and the Jewish Welfare Board vied for the soldiers' patronage. To maintain a newspaper by and for enlisted men, the editors dedicated a significant amount of space to soldier-authored material, especially poetry and sentimental song lyrics. And I just thought this was wonderful, that is how people entertained themselves. They wrote poetry. That was their entertainment. You know, no television, radio, no media. So they wrote poetry. And the Army's Poets column, that's that long skinny column in the middle, every issue had the Army Poets column. And that was begun on May 3rd, 1918, and it was one of the most popular features of the newspaper. It appealed to the soldiers' emotions and creativity and allowed them to communicate their gripes and concerns about their commanders in an untraditional way. Many of the poems depicted lighthearted accounts of camp life. And they did talk about lice. Camp life, from military regulations to lice. I mean, people actually wrote poems about lice and about their commanders and about the terrible conditions on the front. Most, however, expressed deep feelings of loneliness, despondence, and sacrifice. In the Army Poets column, soldiers commented on life in the trenches, homesickness, patriotism, and the camaraderie essential for wartime success. One poem, called To a Doughboy, expressed the restlessness of being in a foreign country at war. Quote, I watched you slog down a dusty pike, one of many so much alike, with a spirit keen as a breath of flame." End quote. Over the course of the newspaper's run, enlisted men submitted more than 75,000 poems, and the editors read them all and selected the ones that they would print. So they had quite an outpouring of writing that was being sent in to the paper. That's one of the poems. "The outpouring of emotion in writing provided a healing outlet for the soldiers on the front, and the soldier-authored poetry supported the mission of the newspaper to maintain high morale and promote the just cause of war." The Stars and Stripes relied on enlisted men to write, edit, and manage the paper, and many of them brought prior newspaper experience from some of the country's leading publications. Now, the editor of the paper was Guy Wisniewski. He was from a newspaper in the States, and they wanted to take his picture and put him as the editor to show the soldiers who was editing the paper, and he said, "This is the editor of the paper, the American soldier." So that's the owner of the Stars and Stripes. Everybody owned the paper. No, and the government did not own the paper. It was all by the enlisted men. Editor Guy Wisniewski clearly acknowledged the writers of the paper. Quote, "Barring an officer or two who had to be around to satisfy Army traditions, the Stars and Stripes actually has been produced by enlisted men, many of the lowly or buck variety. A handful of enlisted men has written and illustrated the paper. I believe, for its size, the most brilliant and erratic editorial staff ever possessed by an American newspaper. It belongs to the enlisted American soldier who took the paper to their hearts, called it our paper, and furnished the inspiration for those of their comrades detailed to the publication to fight the war in a sector that never knew a day without casualties." End quote. General Pershing ensured that the newspaper staff had complete editorial freedom, and no officials controlled the newspaper, and no one censored any of the newspaper's content. So they did not have to send this through the censors. They were able to write whatever they wanted, and some of it was quite irreverent, but they had no censorship by the Army. The editorial policy allowed political news to reach the military community, sometimes with a partisan slant. The regular and irreverent writers such as Wisniewski and Alexander Wolcott became extremely popular because they frequently poked fun at military regulations and commanders. Unlike their German, English, and French counterparts, correspondents traveled to the front lines without military escorts and followed the troops in battle. Despite this freedom, they willingly followed some rules of censorship. They self-censored the paper and submitted their reports through the Army Board of Control and Military Intelligence Service. The board, located in Chaumont, France, x-rayed every article for military secrets. So they had full responsibility for the content, but they couldn't give away where they were stationed and any kind of military battle secrets, so they couldn't print any of that. But they were happy to do that on their own. They would not print any of that. And then the newspaper staff self-censored the publication for names and specific units in France. And they wouldn't run any ads from businesses in Chaumont, France, because that was the general headquarters, and they wanted to conceal that location so they wouldn't print any advertising from that town. General Pershing and top military officers protected and defended the editorial freedom of the paper, and that policy lasted throughout its history. Many career journalists worked on the paper, but the primary writers included Wisniewski, Harold Ross, Alexander Wolcott, and Abian Wally Walgren. This team gathered material, wrote editorials, drew cartoons, and ensured that the paper appeared every Friday. Wisniewski was a second lieutenant who came from the Wheeler newspaper syndicate. He led the newspaper staff as chief editor. Before his stint at Stars and Stripes, he worked as the AEF press officer and a censor at the American Field Test headquarters in Neuf-Chateau, France. The government asked him to explore the feasibility of publishing a paper for the AEF, and he accomplished that task. Wisniewski always emphasized the role of the enlisted men as the creators of the paper. He focused on the operations, and the rest of the writers wrote the articles. The Stars and Stripes staff comprised a colorful assortment of artists and writers. This is Private Harold Wallace Ross. He wrote many of the articles, always with an ironic twist to the news. He came from the San Francisco Call newspaper and several other American newspapers before he joined the 18th Engineers Railway Division of the Army. In 1918, he joined the Stars and Stripes. So these people that were writing had actually been journalists in civilian life, and then, they got called up and enlisted, and then they went to France and continued their journalism career just for a different paper. Fellow staff members knew him for his high energy, but also for his rather abrasive character. From December 17th to April 19th, Ross functioned as probably the, quote, lowest paid managing editor in the history of journalism, end quote, according to his assessment. His superior, Major Mark Watson, recommended Ross for the Distinguished Service Medal for his admirable work with the paper. However, the government rarely awarded the DSM to a private, so Ross never did get the medal, even though his commander clearly felt he deserved it. This was the only picture I could find of Alexander Wolcott. This is a caricature of him. His nickname was Old Vitriol and Violets. He was the New York Times drama critic before the war. He worked at the registrar's office at Base Hospital No. 8 and later transferred to the front in Paris when the war became intense in the spring of 1918. He served as a chief war correspondent for Stars and Stripes until the armistice was signed. He supervised the amusement column, which became a regular, rather lengthy, well-written feature of the paper. He believed that editors should be selective in what they published and should always accentuate the positive to bolster the soldiers' morale. And then later on, I'll tell you a little bit about what happened to all of these men after the war. And some of them did go back to their journalism careers and became quite famous at the time in the 1920s. And he was one of them that continued to write for the New York Times. Private Abian A. Wally Walgren was probably the most well-known of the Stars and Stripes staff among his readers. He was the cartoonist for the Philadelphia Public Ledger and the Washington Post before the war, where he created the comic strips In Bad the Sailor and Tired Timothy. During the war, he served in France with the 5th Marines of the 1st Division. Wally said about himself that he somehow strayed into the offices of the Stars and Stripes and was kept there throughout the war, apparently forgotten by the headquarters of the Marines. Because he did actually wander in. They, you know, recruited him to work on the paper, and then the Marines never got back with him again and made him fight. He just sort of disappeared, and the Marines just kind of, you know, ignored him. I mean, everybody knew he was working for the paper because he had the column. He had the comic column, and it was in every paper, and he signed his name. He was the only one that actually signed his name to his column. Okay, so here are some of Wally's cartoons, and you can see them in the paper too. This is directions for the proper care of the rifle, and at the end of it, he's hitting one of his commanding officers over the head with it. Never pull your overcoat through the bore of your rifle to clean it. Be careful what you eat.
Slum and beans.
Slum tonight, beans tomorrow. Never become too familiar with an officer. Old scout, what'd you think of the chicken I had last night? Walgren's helpful hints column, this was his helpful hints column, appeared in every issue of the Stars and Stripes. They poked fun at Army life, satirized the absurdity of Army regulations, and highlighted the differences between the Army brass and the frontline soldier. His cartoons gave a humorous snapshot of American participation in its first global conflict. Walgren made numerous trips to the war front to gather material for his cartoons and became the most famous cartoonist of the AEF in France since he had the only byline. Wisniewski gave Walgren high praise when he wrote, quote, "Private Abian A. Walgren, formerly of any Philadelphia newspaper you can think of, and the Washington Post, was pried loose from the 5th Marines, where apparently he acquired his undying affection for top sergeants. Walgren is probably the best advertised and worst behaved enlisted man in the AEF," end quote. Private Hudson Hawley and John Winterick later joined Ross and Wolcott to form the Corps Editorial Board in Paris. These four editors became the models for the Stripes' satirical cartoons. They bore responsibility for nearly all the editorials, although the unsigned articles make it virtually impossible to know the author of any of the articles. So as I was reading this paper, you can't really tell who wrote, which editor wrote the paper. They didn't have such distinctive styles that you could tell them apart. But they all pretty much sounded the same. The editors frequently rejected requests from chaplains and congressmen to start a religious column, or one entitled Happy Thoughts. They wanted the focus to be on entertainment, not inspiration. They collectively thumbed their noses at the requests of the officers who outranked them but had no power over the content of the paper. So everybody had lots of ideas of what they wanted them to put in the paper, and they just did whatever they wanted. The military commanders enforced this hands-off policy since they held the paper to its original intention of being by and for the enlisted man. Alexander Wolcott insisted that the editors, enlisted men themselves, knew what the soldier wanted in their paper and they were going to give it to them. As the paper steadily expanded its operation, more writers joined the staff. The roster included Sergeant Seth T. Bailey of the 162nd Infantry, poet Grantland Rice. Grantland Rice, I have a quote from one of the poems that Grantland Rice wrote, who he later became very involved with sports. And this poem is, For when the one great scorer comes to write against your name, he marks not that you won or lost, but how you played the game. So that was Grantland Rice, and he wrote for the paper. Steve Early, the Associated Press correspondent for the Navy, and infantry private Cyrus Baldridge, who became a staff cartoonist. His editor proclaimed that his drawings of the Doughboys have been famous the world around. Wisniewski praised the writers when he said, "It has been said that the Stars and Stripe stands unique in the history of newspaper publication. Well, the American private is the greatest man in the world at fighting or writing or anything." On February 7, 1919, the first year anniversary of the newspaper, Stars and Stripes published several letters of thanks from top-ranking military advisors. General John Pershing, the force behind the paper, wrote a letter that was published, and he said, "On the anniversary of the founding of the Stars and Stripes, it is my great pleasure as Commander-in-Chief of the American Expeditionary Forces to congratulate the editorial, business, and producing staffs who have so successfully labored in the creation of this remarkable newspaper. It has, in my opinion, fulfilled the purposes for which it was conceived and has maintained all the best traditions of journalism. It has been an important factor in creating and supporting the excellent morale which has at all times characterized the AEF." President Woodrow Wilson also wrote a letter to the paper and commended the editors and their efforts to boost the Army morale. He stated, "May I congratulate the Stars and Stripes on the completion of its first year of publication and express my gratitude that it has rendered so interesting a service to the men under arms. The newspaper continually served the needs of the AEF and became an important source of morale for the forces in France. After a year in publication, it was still popular and vibrant and still entertained and informed the troops." After 16 months of serving the enlisted men of the American Expeditionary Forces, the Stars and Stripes published its 71st and last issue on June 13, 1919. This final paper contained many notable items. It included a campaign for the AEF to raise money to care for the war orphans of French soldiers killed in battle. It contained an article expressing Secretary of War Newton Baker's congratulations to the editing staff. It also detailed all the American military successes, including decisive battles at Catigny, Belleau Wood, Chateau Thierry, and Soissons. Finally, a staff article recounted the history of the newspaper by stating, "Stars and Stripes is hauled down with this issue. The Yanks' own paper was for the enlisted man, first, last, and all the time. It is, as far as we know, the only subdivision of the AEF that does not claim to have won the war single-handed. But they say we helped a bit. Besides actual winning of battles, our participation braced Allied morale greatly." End of quote. The article thanked their readers the most homesick and most likable army on earth. The writers face the challenges of reporting from the front while maintaining their editorial independence. Now they celebrated their unique journalistic achievement to boost the morale of the American soldier. The issue ended with a photograph of French children waving and saying, "Goodbye, good night, messieurs les Americans." After the war, many of the Stars and Stripes contributors continued to write notable journalism. Harold Ross and Alexander Wolcott founded and managed the New Yorker magazine, one of America's leading magazines still published today. And I did a little research on them, which I didn't put in this, but both of them, Harold Ross and Alexander Wolcott, were part of the Algonquin Roundtable with Dorothy Parker and some of the other writers in New York at the Algonquin Hotel. And so they continued writing and carousing, and it was during Prohibition, and there was all kinds of drinking going on and speakeasies, and so they were still very involved in, and they started the New York, they started the Saturday Review, and they worked for the New York Times. So they continued writing after the war. Wolcott collected his essays for the Stars and Stripes and published a book called The Command is Forward. Harold Ross's superior, Mark Watson, who wanted him to have a DSM but didn't, Mark Watson won a Pulitzer Prize as a reporter for the Baltimore Sun. Wally Walgren created a syndicated newspaper strip, Who's Scow Herman, in 1939. After the war, Grantland Rice wrote the influential syndicated sports column, The Sportlight. He also founded a motion picture studio of the same name and earned the title Dean of American Sports Writers. Rice continued as a prolific poet, and I showed you one of his poems there. John Church later joined the staff of the American Legion Weekly and wrote for that journal from 1924 to 1938. That became the American Legion Monthly. So some of you might know that publication. He also served on the staff of the New Yorker and the Saturday Review of Books from 1946 to 1969. Steve Early served as the presidential press secretary for both Franklin Roosevelt and Harry Truman. So he went on to work for the presidents. Cyrus Baldridge, the art director, continued his career as an illustrator and stage designer. Having been born in the Civil War and resurrected in World War I, the Stars and Stripes came to life again after World War II, in World War II. Newsman Andy Rooney and writer Bill Malden were its most famous journalists. After the war, the newspaper staff returned to the States, and the paper replaced the military editors with a full-time civilian staff. Stars and Stripes continuously published throughout the Korean War, the Vietnam War, the First Gulf War, and the conflicts in Bosnia, Kosovo, and the Middle East. Stars and Stripes stories today pertain to each theater of operation, and the newspaper draws on reporters and sources from the Associated Press, McClatsky, Scripps Howard, and the Washington Post. So now it's a full-fledged newspaper. Stars and Stripes retains its original mission to publish and distribute a high-quality newspaper to the American military community outside of the continental United States. The newspaper receives part of its funding from the Department of Defense, but most of its revenue comes from advertising and subscriptions. It retains its unique status among military publications by maintaining complete editorial independence, safeguarded by the First Amendment and the United States Congress. General Pershing's vision for the newspaper during World War I continues and is still today an independent newspaper for the military community. Stars and Stripes stands as a primary source of World War I. I mean, the whole war is right there in those papers, and the soldiers who fought it. Nearly 100 years later, it is still readable, humorous, and thought-provoking. The paper gives a fresh insight into the past, reminding us that what is now history was once real life, lived by individuals as full of sensitivities, appetites, and passions and prejudices as we are. The newspaper fulfilled its mission to provide the scattered troops with a sense of unity and an understanding of their part in the overall war effort. It lifted the spirits of the fighting soldiers, connected them with news from home, invoked laughter at the comic side of the military, and boosted their patriotism and morale. The high standards of news and entertainment and the journalistic quality of modern-day Stars and Stripes began in the 8-page weekly editions during World War I. Thank you.
Is the small type just because the paper was scarce, or was that kind of how newspapers of the day, everybody did it that way?
I think that because a lot of it was the paper, but I mean on the front, but they had a small staff and it came out every week. So, and if you'll look at it, the print is this small. So you've got about 20 pages of print jammed into 8 pages of paper. And it seems bigger to me than regular newspapers. So I want you to come and look at this. So it was very condensed, so there was a lot of information, but they were printing out on the field. You know, they had these portable presses that they would carry around with them, and so to get 8 pages out was a huge ordeal in a week, you know. So, but good question. Yeah.
We have another copy of that same collection there in a little better shape, so we'll bring that out afterwards and set it up on one of the other tables here.
You would have to wear gloves with that. I did my original research with the newspapers here at the museum. They have this collection, and it's very fragile, but it's in beautiful shape, and you have to wear gloves so you don't get your chemicals on there. This one is not in great shape, so feel free to touch this one and read this one. And if it falls apart, it falls apart. I'm not trying to keep it pristine, but yes, if you ever want to do research on this, the Veterans Museum we have a copy of that here, so you can read all of them. Yes?
Can these issues be read online?
Some of them are online, but not the whole thing. I got most of these from the Library of Congress. It has a website that has some of them, but they don't have every single issue. They just have, you know, a few. So, and that's where I got. See, this is the paper. This is a page of the paper shrunk to 8x11. And it's dense. You know, it's very dense. But I don't know, we get the Denver Post and it seems like it's only 8 pages long some days. On Tuesdays, that thing is really small.
Any women involved?
No. And that was one of my primary interests. Like, I was going to see if I could find the women's presence in World War I were nurses.
Just nurses.
There were nurses in France, and the Red Cross had a big presence. And some of the women would drive. But no one was fighting, and so they weren't on the front, and so they weren't I was hoping I could find some connection too, because that's my interest too, but yeah. But I did it anyway, you know, even without the women's connection. Thanks.
Any other questions?
But come in January, because I'm doing women spies in World War I. They were spies. They didn't print the paper, but they were.
Well, we record it. We can hear it on them.
So I know the answer to this question, but I think it's really cool that you should tell everyone why you're wearing that outfit.
Yes.
Okay, does anybody know why I'm wearing this outfit?
Because it's Christmas time.
Oh, good guess, but you're on the right track. My presentation is about newspapers, and this is black and white and red all over.
Well, thank you so much, Colleen.
Well, thank you.
Again, and I know you probably have one already, but again, thank you so much for joining us. And please, everybody, stick around. We have plenty of refreshments still.
Yes, and please
and
come
peruse
over and read
that.
This. I brought magnifying glasses so you can read some of these articles and enjoy the poster. Yeah. There's a lot of information on the poster of the editors. So.
And we have several exhibit cases also with items related to World War I. So thank you for joining us, and please join us on the 9th for our last one for the year. It'll be most interesting. Thank you.